evening, Chicago. I am Winter Lake. We are broadcasting from AM 1710 and streaming live at QUE4.com. Today we are going to be discussing the paranormal and the occult as usual, but also in a particular drift, we will be discussing gadgets, drones, and drone warfare. And the weaponization of said warfare. And I have a special guest today who is actually working for a company who is involved heavily in this kind of sales of new technology. And in looking at all of the different drone technology that I have seen, I've been fascinated to talk with her. Barb, are you still with us? Well, she may not be, but she was on a hold line, but neither here nor there. We are going to be discussing drones today. So I guess you're here now, Barb?
Yes, I got disconnected.
It's very good to hear from you. So I gave you a good lead in discussing some of this drone technology. What do you think of it? I mean, what has been going on?
What I think is the unmanned way of attacking and intercepting information by various different governments and militaries is really the wave of the future. I mean, right now, they actually built a drone that's able to operate continuously for 5 years just off of the atmosphere satellites.
Interesting.
This is not going to compare to anything. I mean, it's going to be surveilling and attacking for 5 years just based off the power of the sun.
So it just stays autonomous up in the sky, obviously
yes.
Powered by solar. I mean, do you know what the weapons are on it?
Basically, it's like a missile, and it's able to fly 65,000 feet high and cruise at speeds of 65 miles per hour. Operating range is 2.8 million miles, and it intercepts all the information from 4G mobile phone services. It basically can also attack as a missile. So this is definitely the wave of the future. I mean, I was even looking at some information in Chicago.
Yes.
And the Chicago Police Department is actually going to start implementing drones as part of their combat against crime.
I know. It's so interesting. We're so surveilled under some kind of CCTV system currently. Street by street. I don't see that in New York City, but I've definitely been seeing it here. They have these red light cameras installed with blue lights on top with infrared, and it would not be some great leap for them to just suddenly, you know, we're going to start activating drones and going street by street, and they're so drug obsessed that they're probably scanning for infrareds or heat lamps and I don't know, but things are definitely out of control. I mean, there was even something I had seen that was sent to me about something called the Gorgon star system. It was probably what you were talking about, autonomous flight craft that just,
right.
You know, continuous.
Right, exactly. The aircraft is made by a company called Titan Aerospace. And it's called the Solara, if you want to look it up.
Interesting.
And that's exactly right. And I think that's the wave of the future. Not only that, the thing is that they can wage, not just the police department, but the military, think about it. They can wage wars against nations without us ever knowing. It's not like we're sending troops in. There's so many covert wars that are happening by utilizing drones. So it's really crazy. And I really think that what they're going to do eventually in the future is that the police departments will no longer use helicopters. They'll be using drones.
Just some kind of automated craft where you'll have an officer in a 911 bunker or something, and he's flying around one of these craft, you know, like a drone. Well, they call them bad boys, which is so ridiculous, with cameras and, you know, Hellfire missiles. I don't see how that's even plausible to have those type of weaponry in a city urban environment unless they're, you know, some kind of conducting for a war to come or prepping. I mean, it's a total violation of our rights.
Well, it's crazy, but listen to this. The FAA just released a roadmap on wider use of drones. They're doing test runs right now to see if they can share airspace with commercial aircraft. You know, you're taking a trip to California, you're flying in your aircraft, and, you know, next to you is a drone. This is actually what they want to do. They haven't cleared it yet, but they want to use more of our aerospace to actually have drones flying. I'm telling you, it's the wave of the future. You will no longer see military helicopters and police helicopters. You're going to see drones. I think that's the wave of the future. I really think that is what's going to happen.
They're coming under, it is, you know, there's this auspice of drones as human rights protectors. I don't really even understand that statement. It says something, you know, peace activists have suggested drones should be used as, you know, going around scanning and helping people. I mean, do they really realize the potential that this thing could do? Plus, what if it gets hacked, you know, which is a whole nother discussion. I don't know.
True.
I mean, there was a drone that was hacked, I believe, in Iran. They somehow were able to subvert it.
Right. They can do that. Absolutely. I don't think there's any way to share airspace. I mean, in civilian areas with a drone. I mean, this whole FAA, you know, doing this roadmap is ridiculous. They said that they want to operate it in a safe manner. So how are you going to do that? How is that possible to share air? I mean, this is a weapon. I don't understand how that makes us feel safer. Plus, we don't want drones spying on us.
Have you encountered a drone with your work at Homeland?
I saw. I don't know if it was a drone, but listen to this. Last summer, in Putnam, New York, I saw a black, unidentified, some sort of aircraft that looked like a plane, but it had no numbers on it, and it was black. And I was looking at it and saying, wow, that is really strange-looking plane, because it was smaller than a regular commercial plane. It didn't look like a military plane. It was all black, and I saw it flying. It was flying very low. And I don't know if that was a joke, but I would not be surprised.
It could be perceived as, you know, it's extraterrestrial, we don't know, but it's something totally out of the randomness of things and unexpected, where it could be, you know, some device that's built by the United States government or some government. Was it a triangle?
No, it actually looked like a very strange-looking plane. It was a very thin plane with very, very short propeller, and the wings were very thin. It was very odd looking. It was very covert, and it was odd looking. It didn't have any numbers on it or anything on it. It was flying very low.
Interesting.
I thought that was the weirdest thing. I even asked my friend who's a former air pilot if she ever saw a plane like that, and she said no. And I explained to her the distance of how it was flying, and she said that they're really not supposed to fly that low, because when they're flying that low, the air traffic controllers really can't identify them on radar.
Well, that's probably why it was down so low.
Yeah.
Did it move quietly, or was it loud?
Yes. Oh, it was so quiet. I would have never, ever knew that it was there, because when a plane passes over, it's so enormously loud. You couldn't even hear anything. It was the weirdest thing. And I thought to myself, okay, that is really weird. I mean, there's nothing going on in Putnam, New York, you know, thing to be flying around here unless it's looking for a deer.
I know. But then, well, see, there's a lot. Yeah. There's a lot up there in New York, though. That's a hub for some kind of hardened facilities and some kind of listening station. They have so much up there, you know, let alone just your company.
That's true. That's definitely true. Yeah.
What is this thing that you're working on with these cell phone interceptors?
Oh, okay, cell phone interceptors. All right. Basically, cell phone interceptors. There's all different types of. There are portable ones. There are cell phone interceptors that you hook up to a computer, and basically, what they do is they intercept telephone calls and SMS messages. So, for instance, there's one that they have now that can actually intercept 10,000 calls, 10,000 calls, and it can zero out on your target. It can you can zero it out to four people talking on the phone, and what it does is it gathers not just the conversation, but it also gathers up information like your carrier, your internet service, your name. If you change your SD card on your cell phone, all kinds of information. And what happens is that those that are using the phone would never know that they're being intercepted. There's no way, because it's very covert, and it acts as its own network system, and it's totally transparent. There's no way that you would know that it's intercepting. And basically governments, law enforcement, and intelligence utilize that type of equipment.
And this is what this is what the company has been selling, right?
Right. Yes.
And the company, yes. and this is a device that you can't buy commercially here in the United States.
You're not really supposed to do it unless you are an end user. If you have an end user certificate and you're a reseller and you're selling it to a government or military, you can do that. But you're really not supposed to be utilizing that for yourself. Although, you know what, people make their own. People, you know, just like people hack computers, people make their own interceptors. And there was a guy who just made a cell phone interceptor that can intercept 4G GSM.
Interesting.
For $1,500. He made a system that cost about $1 million that military and the government actually paid $2 million for it. He made it for $1,500.
Interesting. So he made it for $1,500, and typically right. They're vastly expensive, as you have just said. And
millions, yeah.
Yeah, yep. And these in the dealings, you know, you're almost like the broker of these kind of deals. But in looking at it, this individual took what to do that? How did he possibly craft a $1,500 cell phone interceptor?
Basically, what he did was obviously he's a computer tech,
right?
He obviously has a lot of knowledge about computer technology. What he did was that he took apart, he bought parts, computer components, and parts, and he looked at the specs for the average interceptor, and he put it together. So it's not like anyone can do it. You have to. You obviously have to be like a techie, the type of person that could put together a computer,
right?
Whatever. And he was able to do it for $1,500 because he knew exactly what parts they were using, and he just bought parts or took apart other components and extracted the items that he needed, and he built it. And the funny thing is that they have an article about it, and I would imagine that, you know, that's not good that he did that.
Right, and, that he re-engineered it. Well, they reversed engineered it, but he also had to learn how that, you know, the different components that went into it. I mean, I have seen different ones that are used with some kind of foil pan, or they have a projector for a television or something. And I mean, I tried to build one and I found it to be nonsense. So
you actually did? Really?
Well, yeah, I experimented with it last night. I knew we were going to be speaking, and I'd been researching about the cell phone interception, and I really couldn't get it to work. So I think that some of that, I mean, yeah, you have to have some other kind of intuitive knowledge on, you know, what's going into it in order to receive, unless I was just inept. I don't know.
Well, you have to have some kind of mechanical know-how. You have to know, the people that are usually able to build those sort of things are usually like hackers or people who know how to build computers. It's not easy. I mean, obviously, because they cost $1 million.
Yeah.
So it's definitely not. Here's what they say. They said that he created a DIY version of an IMSA catcher. It's a piece of equipment that's used by intelligence and law enforcement.
Okay? Right,
so
right.
So it intercepts all the communication. So it usually costs a couple of $1 million.
Yeah,
and
big money.
And the most expensive, you know why? Because the system itself is expensive, but it's the laptop that's cheap. So the laptop is not the problem. It's the DIY system, and the antennas that are most expensive, and that in itself turns it into like a little spy machine. And this guy definitely was a hacker, because it's saying
absolutely,
that he hacked together the system by emulating and checking and demonstrating other companies' systems.
Interesting.
Because basically what he is he's a security researcher, so a hacker. So he figured out how people were manufacturing them, and he put it together for $1,500. You know, the average person is not going to be able to do that. Yeah. You know?
I know. Well, we'll come right back to that. I'm going to take a commercial break. This is Winter Lake with the Pentacle Hours. We are broadcasting from AM 1710 out of Chicago, streaming at QUE4.com to about 833,000 people, and we will be back shortly. Hi, Barbara. I'm Winter Lake at winterlake.com, streaming live on QUE4.org with Barb. And, you know, Barbara, going back to this discussion of drones, I was looking at this thing, this reference to the first remote-controlled mechanism being developed by Nikola Tesla. I was perplexed by this. Some kind of military application that he was talking about, but he was like some kind of peace lover. But, you know, he seems to have this double-edged sword about him, where he's like, one minute I'm a peace lover, but then again he's developing the proto-technology, which is our modern-day drones now. So, just
yeah,
kind of,
you know, I wasn't aware of that about Nikola Tesla. I didn't know that he...
Yeah, he invented the first remote-controlled boat, and then, I mean, obviously there's a series of other things that he was doing, but his applications for controlling devices, you know, being wireless, you know, he obviously, you know, through Wi-Fi and all these things that we have now, he was like the founder of a lot of these things, and I guess as well as this drone technology, obviously because it is remote-controlled. Do you know how they can remote control such a device? Is it satellites?
They do it via satellite, and it's computer. It's all computer operated through satellites.
So it's just some kind of thing. It's just one satellite picks it up from another, and
right. And
once it's hacked, it's out of control, and it just can end up in an ox cart in Iran, you know.
I think it's very difficult to hack a drone. I think it's been done, but I think it's very, very difficult to do that. I don't think that that's something that they worry about too much. But, yeah, it's definitely possible, and that would be chaotic if they were able to do that. Especially imagine a drone, like the Chicago Police Department utilizing a drone and someone hacks into it. Can you imagine?
I know, especially if it has some kind of thing, or, you know, if they have weapons on it, or it's, I don't know what they're going to do. But, yeah, if they hacked it, then it would become very nefarious and very destructive.
Absolutely.
In your dealings with Homeland, this other thing that came up was about bomb jamming. What do you know about these bomb jamming devices?
Bomb jamming devices are really, okay, first of all, the bombs are usually triggered by a radio control. They're detonated basically off a basic radio frequency coding. And so what the jammers do is they're able to intercept that through, I think, most using electromagnetic energy. And what happens is that they can remotely turn them off. So remember we were talking about how we wondered if people can detonate the bombs like using like a telephone or
right. Yes, we had this discussion. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They can. They absolutely can. They absolutely can. They're using radio frequencies, and it's a code, and it was a particular code. Now, if that code is intercepted by the electromagnetic frequency, they can be dismantled. It can actually stop it from being detonated. And that's what the jammers are for. And there's all kinds of jammers. There's jammers that they utilize on top of a vehicle, so that when you get to the checkpoint or you're going across the border, well, you have like an entourage, you know, a convoy,
right?
And people have bombs, you know, landmines or whatever in the road or whatever, that it would jam them. Now, I want to tell you that sometimes that equipment doesn't always work.
Right.
That equipment, the biggest problem with equipment is that it's so delicate and it is so difficult to use that many governments spend millions of dollars on the equipment and have so much problems with the application of it.
Is that in some of the sales that you did when you brokered your deals? What was the main buyer of the country? Was that Saudi Arabia, or and they had a lot of problems, or
Africa.
Really?
Africa, people don't realize how bad. Well, I shouldn't say that, but I mean, I don't. It's not in the news as often as, you know, the Middle East is, but Africa in general, like in Nigeria and Botswana, it's so terrible. It really is. It's awful. And so there are tons of resellers all over several different states in Nigeria, and there's a huge market for it. The thing is that everybody, you know, anyone who finds out about the government tenders and the military tenders wants to be a reseller because you can make quite a sum of money selling this type of equipment, and there's a great need for it. The thing is that you need to have an end-user certificate. You need to be a bona fide reseller, have a letter of authorization by a government or military.
But you know that's black market. I mean, if they can get a hold of the jammer, then they're going to sell it. So what you sold a lot to Africa, and they would buy it through the intent of disrupting, you know, bombs at checkpoints or on vehicles for entourage or, you know, different, you know, hierarchical people or presidents. And you
most people don't realize that the prisons, they need the jammers there as well. Because, you know, there's all sorts of things that can happen in the prison. People can sneak anything in there and set, you know, bombs off, whatever, and they have jammers in the prisons too, and that's a whole different story.
And they're trying to do what, though? Why would they want to have a bomb in a prison? Just to blow out the wall or to get at somebody? I mean...
They blow up the prison. These are just, militants, people who are just anti-government. They're rebels, and they'll just blow up the prison it's a typical terrorism, in a typical, plot of terrorism. They'll blow up the prison because let's say, you know, so-and-so from whatever cell is in that prison.
I see. So they would have, so it would almost be like gang activity.
Yeah.
But gang activity being different government factions, so somebody would be incarcerated and they would try to get to him. And he's probably incarcerated for his own good, I guess.
Exactly. Yeah. And the other thing the prisons use are the cell phone interceptors because, you know, they want to know what's going on, the conversations that they're having, and, you know, if they're selling drugs in the prison, if they're plotting to escape or, you know, whatever it may be. But mostly the bomb jammers, I'm going to be honest, are basically sold for convoys and checkpoints. Because in the event that there's a vehicle that it has a bomb on it and they're unaware of it, or they get to a checkpoint and there's a side bomber, many things can occur. There's also bombs on the road. They can't see them. They drive over it. And
the improvised explosive devices.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So what they use is something called an IED jammer. And basically what it does is it uses an electromagnetic energy to stop the bomb from detonating, because the bomb is controlled by a radio frequency coding. And what it does is it scrambles up the code and it stops it from blowing up, actually. It's pretty amazing, but like I said, some of this stuff is very, very expensive, and, you know, sometimes it doesn't work.
And it doesn't work. And have you heard back, obviously you have, when something doesn't work?
I have.
So you've made deals. I mean, how do you get through that? I mean, so the bomb jammer didn't work. They got him.
Yeah, listen, I'm just calling you back to let you know the bomb jammer didn't work. And, can I have my money back? can I have my money back? A couple of people in my army died. Now, that's horrible. What happened was, I had a reseller who was a former Marine. He's Iraqi American. He's a former Marine. He actually used to be a translator.
What's his role now? If he's former Marine, then he's just a rogue, or he's merchant, or what would be his definition? Do you even know?
He was a Marine, but he was put there as a translator for the U.S. government. He was a translator between the Iraqi intelligence and the American.
That's a very hard breach. I mean, considering that language, language barrier, and if he was in that role, that puts him in a very lucrative as well as deadly situation. But what happened?
He was there for quite a while, as they're building up the interim government, and he basically helped them figure out what type of surveillance defense technology products that they're going to need, and what manufacturers are available, and they really preferred the American manufacturers.
Interesting.
Was the other manufacturers? It's not about price; it's about the quality. A lot of people like the German and the American manufacturers for this type of equipment. So I spoke to him, and he was very interested. Now he told me that they had a horrible situation; that they had purchased bomb jammers from a company. I don't know if the company was in Russia, and I think they were.
Oh, just some knockoff or something, or not even working gear.
They didn't work. They spent $10 million on jammers.
Wow.
Didn't work.
Well, that's when heads roll. I mean, that's a serious amount of money. And in that deal, so he was tied up with that. Could he get any recourse, or he purchased from you?
They didn't know. Actually, they don't. I don't know what's going on with trying to recoup what they've lost on that deal, but that's why he reached out to me, because now they're really afraid, and they don't want to deal with anybody, any other manufacturers. They want to deal with either Germany or America. And so he reached out to me and told me the story about it, and then told me that that they're interested in X amount of equipment, and how can we get past this ever happening again? Is there any way that I can guarantee that this equipment is going to work? And I said, well, what we do is we bring the equipment over to you, a sample, a prototype, and we do a live demonstration. So whatever the demonstration will show you how to use the equipment, and you'll see that it works.
And so the demonstration would be a vehicle armed, bombed, and then you would show the deactivation through the jammer.
Yeah, we would have to show them. Yeah, we would have to.
I mean, you'd
exactly
think he would have.
And if it works, right?
You would have. I mean, think he would have done that.
Yeah, the tech will go over there. Sales people don't go over there. A tech actually will go over there and do a live demonstration for them.
And you'd think it's spending $10 million that, he might have been smart enough to do a little bit of the front end. I mean, that's just perplexing. So he just kicked down $10 million, probably on the Russian black market, some knockoff, and then he got a bunch of garbage.
They got a bunch of garbage, and I think the manufacturer was a Chinese company.
Yeah, what is going on? Are the Chinese now manufacturing drones?
They're manufacturing everything that everybody else is manufacturing at a quarter of the price. But the thing is that pretty much everybody knows that everything that they manufacture, is the quality is not there. I spoke to so many people, military, intelligence, and they've told me that when it comes to the price, they've seen significant difference, but that almost every device and equipment that they sell, the quality is not even close to manufactured from Germany and America. So that's really bad, because, like I said, that equipment's very delicate, and it's not easy to operate. And when you wind up, paying pennies for something like that, it's probably not going to work. And if it does work, there's not a longevity. It's not going to work for a long time. There's no real. So I think that they'd rather spend the money and buy something that is real good quality. Well, and not only that, the support. It was.
You do have support in your back end. So, I mean,
yeah.
And in the gear, I mean, absolutely, I would agree with you that if you are going to make this type of purchase, I mean, I don't know. The Chinese basically almost utilize slave labor on this kind of thing. I don't even know how they can turn it out. And if it doesn't work, your life is on the line.
You know.
It's amazing.
It's so true. It's not like your cell phone not working. I mean, your bomb jammer's not working. You know, it's cell phone interceptor doesn't work. And they're scouting somebody out for a couple of days who's like some terrorist, some dangerous person. And they're unable to figure out what they're planning. I mean, that could be, that's a waste of time and it's very dangerous. So, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, but China definitely has a bad... doesn't really have like a name in that department, you know.
Well,
they're cheap, but there's also another manufacturer in Poland who's a little bit lower priced than, you know, the German and the American.
Interesting.
They're not so, I mean, not many people that I know have purchased from them, but they don't have the greatest reputation. Yeah, I'm going to tell you right now, Germany and America are number one when it comes to that defense technology equipment.
And it's just really good. They take their time. They piece it together. They engineer it correctly. And these other ones possibly or obviously just rushed. They're using like second-rate steel or some plastic garbage. And, I mean, you know, it's just amazing to me. But they get the schematics. They obviously stole them, which they do. Yeah. And, you know,
he did, absolutely.
Do you know who the actual framer of drone technology was, or is that still an unknown? I mean, or whatever that deal is with them, you know? Was it just the government?
The framer of the technology? I don't know. I don't know for sure, but...
It was probably the government of the United States or some scientist backed or whatever. Because I can't really find that out either. I mean, drones just all of a sudden popped up, like in 08 or something, and now they've come to perfection by 2013 with stealthy death, you know.
I know.
And they're so...
Honestly, I'm going to tell you what I really think. I really honestly think that the drone technology has been around for a very, very long time, and of course, you know, us as the public didn't know about it, and I really think that it was something that was developed... long time before you and I were born. I think that the I don't know if you know, but or you believe, during the time of Hitler, and when they had brought over the Nazi officers, and the scientists.
Oh yes, Wernher von Braun with Project Paperclip.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I really think that a lot of that technology was developed by them. I really do.
They were really into their radio control. You know, that makes perfect sense in dealing with the V weapons.
Yeah.
That they were remote controlled. So absolutely.
Right.
So.
What about the Nazi bell? Remember the Nazi.
The Die Glocky. I know. Yeah.
Whatever happened to the Nazi bell?
The Die Glocky is an entirely different thing, but I know a lot about that. The Die Glocky,
yeah.
The bell. Was a time device that was taken out of the Wenceslaus mine in Poland, and it was brought to the United States, and it was kept at an Air Force base in Ohio, and they were experimenting with it, and then it got out of control, and it crashed in Pennsylvania, and then it took off again, and it has some kind of thing with time distortion with polarity and two diverging directions. I'm sure they have perfected that by now, almost. I mean, and that's a whole different reality in dealing with Die Glocky. And it's fascinating, you know, and the Nazi secret science is perplexing. And it definitely all got hijacked here to the great Fourth Reich of the United States. So there you go.
I definitely think that that's where all the drone technology came from. How did we wind up, you know, being able to go into space? It was the German scientists that came over from Nazi Germany, They're the ones who developed our first rocket.
Yes, Wernher von Braun. Yeah, he was a mastermind. Yeah. And he developed NASA, which is so close to Nazi, it's scary, but the National Aerodynamic Space Administration, which is such an interesting thing, and I know people that work there, and there's this astronaut who sings in space, and he's like got a high pedigree education, and he thinks everything is altruistic, and to me, he's just so blinded, because when I had a discussion with him, I'm like, you do realize your administration was founded by the National Socialists of Germany. And he's like, I divest from that discussion. You know, do you not know who Wernher von Braun was? I mean, it's so funny. They're so altruistic and they don't realize their own roots or if they're even pawns in some kind of thing. And I'm sure, because space being as vast as it is, I mean, we should be much farther along, you know, alternately, probably we are, you know, technologically there could be an entire stealth reality of science and things parallel to what's occurring now, you know.
I think that there's a lot of things that are hidden. Like I said, I think the drone technology might have been around, who knows how long it's been around before that, you know, they actually release the information on it, because I don't believe that we're this far behind. I don't. I think there's much more to all of this that, you know, we know that we're allowed to know about.
Yeah, there's something going on with it. Yeah, that we're allowed to know about, or they show us pictures of some global hawk or the gray evil eagle NQ1C. You know, they give us all these little pictures of different things. And it's not even, is it even relevant? Can it go to space? Can you send it out and bring it back? I mean, there's a lot we don't know. Are they experimenting most of these drones out of Area 51?
They never really, I mean, I was looking at what the FAA was talking about.
Right, with the new
test runs.
Yes.
They didn't say where they were doing them. They didn't exactly say.
That's true. That would be classified. That was kind of a high question, not to try to violate anything. And I understand that, because it would make sense, you know, to pinpoint exactly where they're, I mean, we all know they're out there. It will be scary then when they get parallel to jets, you know, as we're on our flight to L.A. or something, and then all of a sudden look out the window and you see a global hawk.
I know. Well, that's what the FAA is saying. They're saying that they want to do some test runs to see if they could share airspace with commercial planes. And so, but they won't say where they're doing the tests. I do know one thing, though. The test that they ran on the new drone that can fly consistently for 5 years, they were talking about that they flew it over Las Vegas. Yes. They said they did live mapping and monitoring of narcotic trafficking, okay?
Right.
While flying over Las Vegas. But they haven't told us where else they were utilizing it.
And why? I mean, it's just so, I mean, this whole drug thing is so tired. There's so many tons of whatever coming in, and typically through the transients of Mexico, you can't even really justify a global hawk when really it's like, you don't even, there's just so much shadow going on. And I really look at this very skeptically. You know, I'm always, even though I'm kind of in my own world of black magic and my own practitioner, I look at things, you know, with that skewed eye, you know, 90% fraud, 10% real. And some of this stuff just doesn't shake out. The United States government is definitely up to tricks. These other governments are mirroring us and they're stealing from us, like China, which is just crazy, you know. Yep. And then, you know, now they're justifying through the police, they're going to start using these drones to seek out drug thing, which in my mind is just ridiculous.
Well, it's ridiculous. And you know what? You know what's a real crock? The fact that they... Okay, we have border police because our borders are out of control.
They are out of control.
They're insane.
I've got a friend down there telling me all kinds of crazy stuff that goes on.
Yeah. I feel for the people that live near the border, for the law enforcement, because, I mean... The drug cartel that comes through there, I think they are just as bad as any Islamic terrorist, if not worse. They are really, really horrible people. And the law enforcement has to man the border with human beings with guns. Do you think that that's enough? I mean, how many border police do you need to stop those people? Because, I mean, they are absolutely ruthless. They're constantly being killed. They really have no control over it. They're getting past the border every day. Why don't they use drones for that? Now, that I could understand.
Yes, and that won't happen. I don't know what's going on because, yeah. I mean, I'm not affiliated with the cartels, but I know some of the cartels, and they just really run roughshod, and I think that they have the power to manipulate... You know, obviously certain people along that border because they are some bloodthirsty Satanists. I mean, they are decapitating people. They are abducting people right over bridges. They are bringing in whatever they want, and everyone's on the take, and people in denial have no clue. They're poisoning water. They're doing whatever they want, and I totally agree with you. I think I'd put a Predator drone down there with Hellfire missiles, and that would definitely quell something, but that won't happen.
That won't happen. And the thing is that they're always trying to scare us, the media, about the Islamic terrorists. But what about the drug cartel? You know, they're just as dangerous, if not even more dangerous. Like you were just saying, you know, these people cut people's freaking heads.
Oh, they're very dangerous because they're right here. They can get to anyone, anytime. They're in a very organized fashion. And they can go and do a lot. They are worse, and we spend a lot of money and a lot of time, not we, but the United States government in this faction that deals with drones, sending and attacking through the Afghan border, and it's just perplexing. I guess because they're just so up on their terrorism, but still, I mean, I absolutely agree that the cartels are some really heavy terrorists themselves. And, I mean, they will stop at nothing to get their stuff through.
I always thought to myself, I mean, what is the sense of using a drone to catch narcotic trafficking when you can just have drones parading all around the borders and you can catch them before they even get over here? So it just doesn't make any sense.
Well, because we know there's a conspiracy. And we are at the top of the hour, and I am going to take a commercial break, and then we will continue on with our discussion. I am Winter Lake at winterlake.com, streaming on QUE4.org at AM 1710, and we will be back with you shortly.
war on error. We have declared war on error.
Winter Lake at winterlake.com, streaming live at QUE4.org, live at AM 1710, and we have a caller on the line who has a name of Amy, who works for Boeing. Hi, Amy, how are you?
Fine.
So, what seems to be your question? Do you know a lot about drone technology or the construction?
Actually, I used to work for Boeing. I haven't worked there in about 3 years. lobbyist, and yes, I should know a lot about drone technology and use of drones. Very much against it. That's also one of the reasons why I left the company.
Were you sanctioned?
No. I don't know what you mean by sanctioned, but I feel that Boeing, Lockheed Martin, a lot of these aerospace defense companies are making a lot of money on these black box programs that are surveilling the U.S. populace at large. These men are very reckless in their quest for money / power, and they've obviously hurt themselves in the American public.
And it's just, is this going along with the NSA, or is it beyond that? Is some kind of shadow government that has its own agenda to enrich themselves? That's the ultimate goal?
Well, I feel like so much part of Project for a New American Century is the shadow government. You know, you have Dick Cheney and the Bushes, several people that were involved in the Big Eight large oil companies. Do you think that a lot of these things were perpetrated so that we could set up this quote-unquote empire that you will, you know, that we have now, NSA, all this surveillance? I think that this definitely, you know, everybody at the top knows what's going on, and it's a big racketeering puppet show.
And the puppet show is being that there's a facade that the United States people see, and then there is this background entity or government. And in Boeing, what was your status there? What did you do?
I was a small business liaison officer for Verizon. So what that job entails is I was in charge of all the small business dollar contracts for the Philadelphia site. I used to go to Washington, D.C. And represent the craft interests, and also go to local politicians, local meetings and jump in and stuff, and go lobby with local people.
So in the lobbying, it was a lot of interaction, trying to push the agenda. Did you see the forefront of drones, or were you mid-range?
I saw the forefront of the defense industry, period. Being in my position, I was out there trying to court these politicians for these crazy contracts, these different types of programs, telling politicians why we need so-and-so, you know. It boggles my mind.
We're spending
billions of dollars on, you know, so, for instance, like Chinook helicopters, right?
Correct.
You know, Chinook helicopters. We're still, the government still is on the contract to buy 57 new Chinook helicopters at $24 million apiece.
But that doesn't make sense. That vehicle is flawed. That Chinook, isn't that a killer? I mean, there's been a lot of wrecks.
They modified the Chinook to put rear gun window in the aircraft. You know, it used to be a rescue vehicle, you know, quote unquote rescue vehicle, and it's very much an assault vehicle in many ways.
And these can be urbanized.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Do you know any particular time when this deal's supposed to go down for the $54 million, or is that just kind of...
Oh, no, it's already in play. It's been going on for a while, and, like, what the American people don't realize, we're building all these drones and stuff like that, but all these other governments are involved in this as well. And, you know, it's so funny to me about, like, all these governments are getting, like, pissed off now, finding out about the U.S. spying on them, but, like, they've been in our pocket trying to help us, you know, in this war and do all these other things against these different countries. I don't know why they didn't think that we wouldn't be turning our back on them also. If they're, you know, you're our ally, you know, we're only interested in you for monetary interest or whatever, whatever you can bring to the table, but really, you know, we're looking at you regardless.
Right. So it's just a totally, you know, I used this reference earlier, like a Fourth Reich mentality. It's our way. We have this exceptionalism, the United States of whatever it is.
It's ridiculous. It's the biggest load of bullshit ever. Because, you know, we have these assault aircraft, right? So, like, you know, we think about these things with Israel or whatever. You know, people talking about these are drones and these drone strikes. This is crazy stuff going on. You know, what people don't even realize, you know, half these, you know, contracts that we have, these big government contracts, all have to have offsets. And a lot of these assault vehicles that we're making to go to war, you think about our allies and stuff, you know, is the Israelis have a big industry for electronics in assault vehicles, like the V-22 Osprey. All of the control box in the cockpit is made in Tel Aviv. You tell me why. You know, why are we giving all of these, like, quote-unquote countries, like India? India makes part of the fuselage for the Chinook aircraft. Now, why is that?
I did understand, but that was very kind of classified and hush-hush on where things are made. And, you know, that shouldn't be, because those are tax dollars. And if we are manufacturing these devices in Tel Aviv, you know, the United States people should supposedly know, you know.
Yeah, but you know what? These Americans have no idea where these assault vehicles, you know, where they're pushing these. They could be manufactured, quote unquote, in America, but people have no idea where they're getting the parts from.
Yeah, so the parts are made.
By parts, I also mean assembled fuselage. You know what I'm saying? So what Boeing essentially is trying to do in America is make most of its factories assembly lines, so they can bring in these pieces of the aircraft that were made in other countries where we bring offsets to, and just assemble them, you know, quote-unquote, it's American-made, but really it's not.
Yeah, quote-unquote American-made, and it's not, because you've got your fuselage that's manufactured in India.
All these countries that are, quote-unquote, our allies and have these interests, these forwarded interests in these countries, they have interest in American warfare. That's what it is. And, you know, it's not really this war economy. The American industrial economy has ruined America and has ruined the world. And, you know, it continues. And so somebody stops it and says, you know what, this is wrong, and we're not going to let America run this way anymore. And some other country decided to get up. You know, like, we're going to be completely out of hand. Like, lunatics are running the show here.
And you're saying that the commerce of war is the industry for the United States. And as a lobbyist.
No. I'm saying that the American industrial complex is the war, because when you think about, you know, like the American military industrial complex, you know, this country isn't like run on that necessarily, because you think about the pharmaceutical industrial complex. Think about all these huge drug companies that have these government contracts with the VA, right? You think about all this stuff, when you think about, you know, who's really making money off of the war, you know, all these drug companies are, all these, like, these chicken hawk politicians that are voted for the war, that really don't support their vets and are voting to cut veterans' benefits and all this stuff. You know, there's a lot of people out there that have made a lot of money off the war that, you know, don't. Would never even think to put their life on the line and anybody in their family's life on the line, but they want that money.
Yeah, they do want that money, you know. And what got you into being a lobbyist? It just something you kind of fell into?
Yeah, it's something I fell into when I was working at the Boeing Company. It's something that I didn't necessarily set out to be there, but something that I fell into very quickly.
Right.
Because also, I had the unit I worked for in the military was very prestigious.
Right.
I was at the 3WS, the 53WS in Scott Air Force Base, Illinois. And that's like one of the crown jewels, if you will, of the THTC, which is Tactical Airlift Commander. And so I had a lot of really good contacts.
Are they holding the command center? So the command center for what? I mean, that's just, well, I know Boeing is in Illinois, isn't it? Is their headquarters here?
Well, Boeing's headquarters is in Chicago because it used to be in Seattle, but they moved it to Chicago because we didn't have enough. We as a company needed the pull out there in those Midwest districts that we didn't have. So people made that big move to Chicago so we could have in those, like, really key Senate districts.
Right.
So that's why Boeing went to Chicago.
Interesting. So it was all tactic. It was all necessary in order to carry
absolutely
on with the agenda.
It was like it's even more rules for whatever contract you're trying to get. Absolutely.
Now, is Boeing, are they the main manufacturer of most of these drones? Well, manufacturer is such a vague word when we've just discussed that most of
them. I think Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, I think they're all in it together. I think Northrop Grumman actually might have us on the drone as far as I'm concerned.
Interesting. So various companies, and Boeing is...
Oh, yeah, absolutely, various companies, but absolutely.
But, and Boeing is chomping at the bit to get more of the action, and that's where you kind of stepped out of it?
Well, no, I just felt like I really couldn't support the job I was doing anymore. I couldn't do it in good faith.
Right. I mean, it's because the agenda was they want to become merchants of war or something, and you weren't interested in that.
Well, my problem was a little bit different. I had just gotten out of a war and got my job at Boeing, like Boeing recruited me. And so I just felt like these men with college degrees, these white men with college degrees, coming from like this ivory tower of male privilege, white male privilege, had no idea what war had actually been like, and they couldn't even comprehend what they're always talking about the war fighter or whatever. They couldn't even comprehend what these other people, these men were going through. And it really stuck at me. So I couldn't keep going to work every day, good face, when I quit.
Right. Very interesting. Well, it's good speaking with you, Amy, and I appreciate you calling in. And we'll have to talk again about that topic.
Absolutely.
And I am Winter Lake, winterlake.com, streaming at QUE4.org, and at AM 1710 to about 833,000 residents and a global reach that is, I believe, also being pirated, according to some notes that I have received on the Cyrus satellite radio channel, something X something, and possibly being pirated out of an LA channel as well. So that should be interesting and something for me to discover later. I am going to just play us a little bit more music, and then we are going to return to Barbara, my Homeland Security friend.
I want to know how to survive in the nightlife. The truth and dare of the drug for the first time. Click my heels and dance with the heat rise. Survive in the nightlife. I want to know how to survive in the nightlife. The truth and dare of the drug from the baseline. the truth and dare of the drug for the first time. Click my heels and dance with the heat rise. I want to know how to survive in the nightlife.
Live, QUE4.org, the top of the dial at AM 1710. And we are discussing with Barbara some more frightening future, the battlefield of drones. So what do you think, Barbara? Did we have any new information about this drone technology?
Yes. I just discovered, you're not going to believe this, the first drone that was ever created, manufactured, was created by a Hollywood actor named Reginald Denny.
Interesting. Now, was it just something on the internet, or is it something through your network?
Actually, I found it on Wikipedia.
Interesting. So it's pretty open.
Yeah.
So it's an open source. And it could almost be something where it's like, fabricated, because almost Wikipedia being, what it is, some kind of thing can be mentioned. But what was this Hollywood star's role? What did he do?
Well, he was a former British Royal Flying Corps during World War I. And he migrated to the United States to become an actor. And he did make a name for himself in Hollywood, but his interest was radio control model aircraft.
It's fascinating.
Yeah. So he formed a partnership, Reginald Denny Industries, and opened up this company called Radio Plane. And he utilized the design that he bought from a gentleman by the name of Walter Wright in 1938, and actually manufactured the first large-scale purpose built drone.
Interesting.
The first one ever. And what happened was this saying that it was called the RP-3 and RP-4, and our military purchased several of those drones.
So it does go way back, like you said. That's almost pre-World War II.
Yeah. Actually, they purchased the RP-4 and RP-3 for World War II. And you're not going to believe this. Marilyn Monroe was a technician at Denny's company. She was a technician at the radio plane plant.
But, Barbara, don't you think that might be disinformation? I mean...
No. There's a picture of her at work.
Is it her, though? I mean, it's so... Because, Marilyn wasn't she... Well, I don't know. There's so much mystery around Marilyn, too. I haven't figured her out either. Her whole connection, or how she ever came around. She was in the hierarchies of government. I don't know. Was she a spy? There was something. Yeah, that might be something to that. It would take some...
There's actually a picture of her at work. She's in the factory, and they said that what happened was a photographer went there to take pictures of the drones, and he saw her. And he thought that she definitely had potential as a model. So after he photographed her, he tried to cultivate her career as a model, not a Hollywood actress, but as a model. And they show the picture of her at the plant working. I think that this could be true. But listen to this; it even gets more interesting. The actual creation of the drone really came from the Austrians.
So it was the Austrians. It goes back to the source that we were talking about.
Yes. In the earliest record use of an unmanned aerial vehicle for warfare was on August 22nd, 1849, when the Austrians attacked the Italian city of Venice with unmanned balloons.
I see.
That were loaded with explosives.
But that isn't really radio technology, but it seemed where they could develop from the beginnings of it. They could from that build on that, and it's the Tesla connection with his radio boat, and then they just are putting two and two together. This thing with Marilyn Monroe, though, that is really weird. She is such an interesting character from her interludes with these different individuals. I don't know what is going on with Marilyn Monroe.
Something very odd about her. Like, first of all, it's very strange that she was working as a technician in a drone manufacturer.
Yeah, that just doesn't make sense.
I know. I'm telling you, I think she was a spy.
Yeah, there's had to be something, because she had interludes with Anton LaVey. She had interludes with these other officials of other governments. She somehow ended up in Hollywood. it's got to be borderline disinformation or something. But then we absolutely know that she made it to the echelons of government through JFK, being her mistress, and then being found dead after this whole thing. And I'm actually going to have a JFK show, I'm thinking on Thursday, talking about some of that conspiracy. But this thing with Marilyn, I don't even know what to begin about this woman. I mean, I'm starting to think that I'm being surrounded by spies that are women. I don't know.
I think she was definitely a spy. I definitely think she was.
What was her?
Now, if this is true, that she was a technician for Radio Play, that even that to me solidifies it, because what is she doing? I mean, working in a factory as a technician for a drone? What the hell?
Well, it's too early. The timing might be wrong, or she was manufacturing something. She might have been in a factory, not really knowing what they were building. But, you know, was it on the West Coast, or where was it, do you know?
I think it was in California.
Yeah, it was on the West Coast.
Yeah, it was in California. It was in I think it was in the Hollywood area that the factory was. And there's a picture of her at the factory working. And it was from 1944, and Yank magazine had the advertisement for Radio Plan in their magazine, and she was modeling, and it was for her company. And then that photograph made the photographer realize that she had a lot of talent, and he helped her push her modeling career.
You know, do you know a lot about Marilyn? I mean, do you have a file on her or something, Barbara? Are you sitting at your echelon and you're opening up your classify? I think I'm remote viewing you, and there's something I need to know. So you're going to have to tell me someday. You can't, because I'm kind of thinking that I see you. You're sitting up in this, like, big, huge, probably place, and you have this secret file on your desk. You know, you got a picture of me with a dart in it. I'm just kidding. And then you have Marilyn Monroe declassified. I don't know.
I do. I can't say no more. Nah.
But it's interesting.
No, honestly, I really don't know that much about her. Come on, you know, I mean, I've heard a lot of people say that they thought she was a spy, but you know, it was just how, you know, they say it was suicide, and then they say she killed herself. It was suicide, and they're saying that the government killed her. So automatically, people feel as though she knew things that she should know, and then you almost wonder how did this woman wind up dating the president?
Yeah, and you know, really, you're going to be that beautiful. You're going to be Marilyn Monroe, and you're all of a sudden going to down a bunch of pills and die on your bed. I mean, there's a lot that just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't think that she really had any kind of bouts with depression. I don't know. Did she? I mean, she was married to these different individuals, and even they were kind of nefarious. Was it just about getting a bankroll, or was she conducting business?
You know, they were always trying to say she had all kinds of mental problems and struggled with depression, but, you know, some people say she was, like, mind control, Hollywood mind control. You know, the conspiracy theorists say that Marilyn Monroe was, like, a mind-controlled Illuminati puppet, you know?
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know about that. I'm not sure. I don't think she was. I think she was a spy.
Yeah, I'm kind of concluding that she was. In her house, was she living big? Was she living large? Did she die with a lot of money in some big house?
Yeah.
She did?
She's not like one of those Hollywood stars that, you know,
was
they
broke
die
or something.
Alone and broke.
Yeah, right.
Her career wasn't, I don't think her career was dissipating, and I don't think she wasn't broke, but they're always saying that she was in and out of mental wards, having nervous breakdowns. She was constantly popping pills. Her mental state wasn't good. And, you know, those are the claims they had about her. But sometimes I think that was just a lot of, they were putting up a facade, you know, a mask as to, you know, who she was. But, you know, so maybe in the end, when they had to get rid of her, it didn't look so strange that she would kill herself. You know, somebody who's that mental. scrambled. You know, you would believe it.
Right.
I mean, that's just me. I don't know.
So, yeah, like, a lot of this doesn't add up. One, she didn't die broke. So she probably had that $1 million. She had the big house off Mulholland Drive, or so I don't know where she was. I've been all through Hollywood. I guess I should take the tour. I mean, you'd think I would take a tour with all the acting or whatever I've done over there, but it's odd. There's just some things that don't add up. She got really close to the president. Nobody really knows how that happened.
How did that happen?
I mean, was JFK so enamored with her? I mean, I don't know. I mean, he was a philanderer. He was a fatalist. But, okay, yeah. So, but one thing away from that, we know that she had some kind of connection with him, and he was assassinated, and then, what was the time frame? How long did Marilyn die after that?
I thought that Marilyn died with that same, I don't know exactly, but I thought that she died the same year that he died.
So she died shortly thereafter of a drug overdose, supposedly.
Yeah, she was 36 years old.
Wow.
Listen to this. This is something that I heard about her. People, conspiracy theorists say that she was an MK Ultra mind control, you know, Illuminati mind control individual, and that they messed with her mind, you know, psychological programming, and she was like their high-level little puppet, you know, shadow elite. Yeah, you could say like a spy, because she was able to, you know, get very intimate with the president and in you know, the upper echelon and find out what was going on, and it throw people off because she seemed like this beautiful woman, but she was like she was a mess, a depressive mess, popping pills. Who would be suspicious of such a person? But that's what they say, that she was a Hollywood monarch slave. I don't know about that, because these days, everybody is. They accuse everyone of.
Right. Yeah, it's just it's an easy way to just marginalize someone. And, I mean, I don't think her career was in some kind of pitfall. She was well-respected. She had a lot of money. I don't really know if she had bouts of depression. We all get depressed. Maybe she had some of that. I am starting to think that maybe she was silenced. And I stay away from the conspiratorial things a little bit. I mean, I'm delving in it, obviously, but probably her affiliations with JFK had gotten her killed. I mean, if she was an Illuminati creation, that just means that something involving with mafia or some entity that had a lot of money. But she definitely, her voice went silent for whatever reason. And, you know, and there was even something, I think, when they discovered her, it was 24 hours later, and then there was some doctor who signed off on something, and that could have been an agonizing death.
But if they did kill her, it really, you know, no one would question it, because the media was always talking about her going in and out of mental wards and, you know, bouts of depression and popping pills. So, I mean, it's not so stunning to find her that way, that she had died of an overdose, whether she did it on purpose or it was accidental. It wouldn't be so, you know, unusual. Yes, she was beautiful. Yes, she was very rich. Yes, she was well respected. But the thing is that they made her out to be a mental mess.
Yeah, they totally did. And the media was doing that. Do you think that they made her out to be a mental mess, and then it was like, when it did occur, obviously, you know, America or whatever would just accept it, or they could have driven her to it, but there's a lot of mystery around her. But this thing about her being on the assembly line, and then, you know, even during the World War II years, and then something involving some other guy. And then even later, I think JFK's brother was assassinated, and yes, he knew something. I mean, there's a lot of conspiracy with it.
Yeah, Yeah, it's really odd. There was even like this article about people who knew her, Hollywood friends. They said that her house was highly surveillanced. It was under high surveillance. Just an incredible amount of surveillance equipment. I know that a lot of celebrities do have that, but they said it was like really odd. Like almost like somebody who's like paranoid would have that much equipment in the house.
Yeah, that's something that is. I mean, that's something that with their JFK involvement. You know,
probably that's the reason. Yeah.
You know, she's a president of the United States. If that came out, there would have been a lot of exposure. It was a different time then, obviously, with the communists, you know, and everything with that. And was she installed by the communists pretending to be a playgirl, you know, getting something,
True. You know,
information. And then JFK went down, and then she went down. And I think all these other people were killed as well, like... If you look at from the circle of JFK and then all these other things that go on, it's like you could put together this family tree of murder or something.
Yeah, I know. The Kennedy family, they had a lot of tragedies surrounding them and within their family.
Yeah, and I don't believe in that. I think that was definitely something forced. You know, there's just too much tragedy.
That's right. Absolutely.
You know.
Yeah, I think she definitely was some kind of a spy. I don't know.
She had to be, and she was playing a role, and the role was to get near the president, get information, or have something on him.
Yes.
And obviously she did, at least to some knowledge. Whether he was really into it, I don't know. I think, what would Jacqueline Kennedy do? I mean, she just was so quiet over these past years. But I guess they put the fear in her. She witnessed that murder.
I think she decided to just shut up and stay out of the media. Because, I mean, so many people died around JFK, including JFK, that I would imagine she was probably frightened.
Yeah, she just became a New York socialite, you know.
Yeah, and stayed out of politics and out of the media.
Yes, she did. She really did. And she was in New York. And she would attend these seminars. And then her son, there was something that happened. He was flying his Cessna out, and something happened. He took his plane and crashed it. Just too many, like, odd things.
I know. You know what? He decided to fly his plane, and he had a broken leg, and there was frost on the wings, and the sister of his wife said, you know, we shouldn't fly the plane, there's frost on the wings.
Yeah, we shouldn't.
Yeah, it's very dangerous. He said, we're going to go anyway.
If that's what they said, we don't know.
I don't believe that for anything.
I don't think he was stupid. I mean, he had that magazine. He was on top of the world. He had $33 million. You know, he had this high pedigree, beautiful wife or whatever. I mean, I do think it's kind of crazy. Oh, let's just all get in this little plane and go fly in a fog.
Yeah, exactly. I don't believe that. I don't believe that that's why the plane went down. I believe that the malfunction of the plane was something that he could not see with his eyes. It was something else. It wasn't something obvious like frost on the wing where, you know, something that someone would point out. And of course he's not going to drive the plane if he knew. I mean, who the hell wants to...
No, unless they said there was some pressure situation that they wanted to get away from something. And you know what? This guy had more money than God. Why in the heck did he have some stupid little plane? I fly occasionally, and I know exactly what type of plane he used. And going into fog bank is just stupid. And definitely with a broken leg, you're not going to be able to work what are known as pedals for the flaps on the floor of the plane. And, you know, you've got all these other variables. You'd almost need an instrument rating. And so you've got this man, this other Kennedy child, with all of these things going on, getting in this rickety plane and crashing it. That's just, unless it's utter stupidity.
Why would he do that?
It just does. See, again, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up. You know, why would all those two women get in there? You know, because they're smarter than that. They're like, look, why don't we just go take a jet? It's right there. You know?
Air money?
Or, oh, dude. I mean, come on. You know, she had money. You know, let's go get in this little, what is now, I think it was some Cessna. I have to do more of my research, but that was just some of the craziest thing. He was totally being petted and groomed for the next presidential race. And, you know, and he was like all up on his magazine and these things that were going on.
I think they got rid of him. You know what? When they did the investigation on his plane, they said that the autopilot to keep him on course was off. The suit was off. So that was suspicious.
So it declined, because his whole thing, well, that's completely tampered. Because it's he hit water, so he thought his up was down and down was up or something. I mean, who knows what the speculation is?
Yeah, but that's what the investigator said, that the water was off, that's odd.
Very odd.
Yeah, things are not adding up. But you know what? The media doesn't talk about anything that they're supposed to be silent about. So that's about as much as we'll ever know.
And that is about as much as we'll know, Barbara. And it's good chatting with you. And I am Winter Lake at winterlake.com. And we will chat again, Barbara, probably next week at this time.
Fantastic.
So you have a good night.
You too. Take care. Thank you.
Bye. And we are streaming live at QUE4.org, and I am Winter Lake, and I apologize about that. I could figure that out. It's been a very interesting discussion today. I have been talking with some very interesting people, and I do feel that I'm being surrounded by spies, Jason. Don't you think? I think I am.
I am a spy, and so are you.
But I think I am surrounded by beautiful women who are working for the government who are trying to get to me. There's my paranoia. Don't you think so?
No, I'm just trying to get you.
Man, brother. Should we have some crosstalk? Who is this young lady that just entered this arena? Is she on for next?
Yeah.
Let's plug you in. And my name's Winter. How are you today?
I'm good. My name's Laura.
And so what are you going to be doing today?
I'm going to be sharing some music made in L.A., and I'm going to be talking to Gabriel Tenorio, who's going to be sharing about East L.A. music history.
Fascinating. And are you a musician yourself or no?
Yeah, I dabble.
So you dabble. Is it the guitar or anything interesting?
It's the jarana. It's from Veracruz, Mexico.
Wow. Have you been down to Mexico recently?
It's been about 2 years.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Are you along a board?